tonight on Access TV. Live live with Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh.
Hope you got rubber sheets, because our comedy gets messy.
With Drew Frazier, Pete Dominic, Rachel Feinstein, Brett Ernst, and your host, Susie Essman.
And you never know what's going to come out of my mouth.
From the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, live, all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, your host, Susie Essman.
What a good-looking crowd. Did I fuck you? You look so familiar to me. Did I fuck you? No? You sure? Wow. You know what? I forget entire relationships. That's what happens in my life. I ran into an ex-boyfriend recently in front of the Museum of Natural History on 77th Street in Columbus, and I'm standing there talking to him thinking, I lived with this guy for 4 years, and I could not remember a thing about the relationship. The only thing I could remember was every night in bed doing this. What are you doing? It's the only thing. The little things that just stick with you, you know. But I now I'm an old married woman, and I actually got married late in life because I had really bad role models. I mean, every couple in my family hated each other. My grandparents were married 70-something years, and I know, exactly. And apparently my grandfather had a twin that died in infancy, and my grandmother used to always say to him, the wrong twin died, Izzy! So this is what I grew up with, you know what I'm saying? So it took me a long time, and I married a guy who had 4 teenagers. I know, I'm a brave woman. And when I first met them, I didn't know how to deal with them, so basically I bought their love, is what I did. And it worked, because I would meet them, I would see them for the weekends, and, you know, they were all athletic, and I'm not athletic at all, and they'd be like, let's go kayaking, let's go skiing, you know, let's go camping. I don't camp. If God wanted me to camp, she wouldn't have invented the Ritz-Carlton, all right? So I would say, you know, let's do something I'm good at, let's go shopping, and they followed me like I was a Pied fucking Piper. And my mother used to say to me, you know, you can't buy their love. No, you can. They're like Russian mail order brides. So now I got these kids and I got these teenage girls I'm responsible for. And, you know, I worry they're having sex, and nobody wants to believe their daughters are having sex. And then they get flowers from the New York Knicks. It's just, you know, it's a whole thing. Nobody wants to believe their parents are having sex. You never believe your parents are having sex, right? No, I used to think my parents were playing cards. I did. I'd walk by their room at night. I'd hear my mother shout, hit me. I thought they were playing gin rummy. And now I'm responsible to, teach them about sex. You know, my mother never taught me shit about sex. She would say things to me like, why buy the cow when you could get the milk for free? This annoyed me on so many levels, you know? Like, first of all, not only am I not a cow, but I'm lactose intolerant, okay? And the implication of that is basically, you know, if you sleep with him, he's not going to want to marry you. What does she think I want to marry any of these assholes I was going out with? I wanted nothing to do with them, you know? I would go out with these guys and I would always have these ding-ding moments, you know, these moments where it would be like ding-ding-ding-ding-ding. The bells would go off that I should, like, run, get away, but I would stay. And sometimes the bells were ringing so loudly Marley Matlin could have heard them, but I stayed, you know? Like, there was the guy who told me that his inner child was Dame Judi Dench. Ding, 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 ding. Or there was the guy that every time we would have oral sex, he would put on a lobster bib. And that's when I was going down on him. Ding, ding. Anyway, so I went out with a lot of assholes. But you see, I give my daughters different advice. I say they should have sex with the guy immediately. Because I think you have to find out right away if the sex is bad or good. And bad sex, by the way, is a concept that men don't even have. They stick it in anywhere and they're happy. But for women, you know what I mean? For women, you're thinking to yourself, can you get into a marginally erogenous zone? And meanwhile, he's got his penis in your eye socket. And it's just like, you know, it's just not working, you know. So I gave advice nothing like my mother. I've never been like my mother. I never looked like her. I was always thin until menopause, and now I have to wear these Maud jackets. But My mother was always like Eastern European, like big Eastern European peasanty looking. Like she looked like if she lifted up a skirt, there'd be a huge brisket underneath there, you know? But here's what happens. When you have teenagers, you suddenly become your mother. This is what's happened to me, okay? I always thought I was cool and hip, and I work on an HBO show where I curse all the time, and I work in nightclubs. No, once you become teenagers, you become a freaking idiot, all right? A couple of years ago, I was in the car with Cindy, my youngest, and Fergie comes on the radio. And she's like, oh, Fergie, Fergie, I love Fergie, turn it up, I love Fergie. And I said, just making conversation, oh, Fergie, doesn't she sing with the Black Eyed Chili Peppers? Well, this is the funniest thing she ever heard, okay? And she starts laughing, laughing, and rolling her eyes and rolling. And by the way, the fact that I get eye rolled at now is so appalling to me, because I used to be queen of the eye rollers, okay? I was so good at it, you could actually hear my eyes rolling, okay? So she's laughing, 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 and all of a sudden I have a flashback to like 35 years ago, and I'm in the Oldsmobile with my mother, and we're listening to the AM radio, it's like Murray the K or Cousin Brucey, and my mother turns to me and she says, isn't that Paul McCartney on the Rolling Stones? And I think, what a fucking idiot she is. What kind of moron is my mother that she doesn't know that Paul is a Beatle? What kind of imbecile gave birth to me that she thinks Paul is a Rolling Stone? And now here I am 35 years later, and now I'm the fucking idiot, okay? It all comes around. But let me tell you, how old are you? 24, you're a baby. Let me tell you about your whole lame generation, all right? I'm gonna tell you what the problem is. Your whole generation with your safe sex. In my day, safe sex is if you did it without handcuffs, all right? And your bike helmets. The bike helmets are the ruin of your entire generation. You got your helmet on and you're all protected and swaddled in there, and your elbow pads and your knee pads, and you're all protected, If I wore a bike helmet in my neighborhood when I was growing up, I would have been laughed out of the fucking neighborhood, okay? Laughed off the block. We didn't have bike helmets. We didn't have child safety caps on the medicine. I once swallowed an entire bottle of my father's phenobarbital, and I lived to tell the tale, all right? All right, wait a minute. And this is the thing that really annoys me the most. We didn't have a little car seat in the back, little seat you're all strapped in. We didn't even have seat belts. We'd be in the back seat flailing around, banging your head against the window, you know, banging, getting concussions. And let me tell you something. And I know I'm gonna get in trouble for this because I understand it's a real issue, et cetera. But this entire concussion syndrome with the high school athletes, it's because they didn't get enough fucking concussions when they were kids. They didn't build up the immunities to the concussions. I got so many concussions falling off the monkey bars, which that might not be politically correct to say anymore, I don't even know, but banging my head. And look how good I turned out, okay? Are you guys ready to have a great show? We have a great lineup for you tonight. You ready? All right. We will be right back after this commercial, and we have some really funny comics for you. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Drew Frazier is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Welcome back, everybody. Our first comic is a very funny guy. You've seen him on Comedy Central. I had the pleasure of working with him recently. Please welcome the very funny, the very talented, the very, very handsome, Drew Frazier.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. All right, folks, lower your expectations. Come on now. Susie Essman, everybody, give it to her. Come on. Come on. Come on. She's right. This is a very handsome crowd. You guys look great. Look like you're taking care of yourselves. Anybody going to the gym, working out, trying to stay in shape? Anybody? Yeah. All right. Three people. Okay. All right. The rest of the room said, fuck it, right? Yeah. I don't blame you folks. Shit, I'm lazy too. I can't get to the gym. I'd rather get sick and lose weight than go to the gym. Anybody else? Yeah, I am happy laying in bed with a collapsed lung. Like, ooh, my stomach is gonna be so flat once I recover from this shit right here. The hell with the gym. All I need is one more car accident. I'll be at my ideal weight. The hell with working out. I'm gonna run a stop sign this weekend. Get ready for my high school reunion. I am lazy. Because it's hard to lose weight, right? Hard to lose weight, right? Especially in this country, right? Yeah, we got too much food over here, don't we? Yeah. We got more food at the gas station than most third world countries. Yeah. Yeah, we got so much food over here, folks, we play with it. Yeah. We actually boil eggs. And then hide them. That's Easter, people. Easter, 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 Easter. You know what? The Catholics should be laughing. The Jewish people, not so much. Eat your eggs. He ain't coming back. Okay, not everybody read the book in here then, right? Okay, all right, all right. Plus, when you do decide to go to the gym and work out, a gym teacher tell you, you know what, you want to lose weight, you got to give up stuff. You can't eat past 7:30. Shit, I get hungry at 9, the hell with you. You can't drink alcohol. Oh no, I got kids, I need a drink every now and then. You can't smoke weed. I told you, I got kids, I need to get high every now and then. Anybody else here smoke weed? Yeah. All right, 8 of us, all right. $1 billion industry, and we are the only 8 that's in here buying this shit, right? Hell, I like to get high and then sit around the house and philosophize. You ever do that? Just high as hell, drunk as hell, sitting in the house thinking about stuff. Like anybody here ever pee the bed in their adult life? Nobody, just me and this young lady right here, we're the only two. So nobody else in this entire room ever had that dream that you were going to the bathroom, then woke up and realized you actually were going to the bathroom? Anybody ever pee the bed, then turn the mattress over and realize you peed that side last week too? Anybody here ever fart, then walk away, and then watch other people as they walk through the fart? Have you ever done that, people? That is hilarious! Especially if you catch somebody with their mouth open. Oh, you don't ruin their entire afternoon. Anybody here ever take a shower, get out, and then have to take a doo-doo? Ain't that a bitch? Now you have a decision to make. Do I go back in here? I gotta go, the train is coming, shit. I timed this shower, I ain't got time to take another shower. I gotta go. Boy, I hope she don't wanna lick my butt later on. I'll tell you that right now. Woo, that's gonna be a shitty decision on her part. I gotta go, I'm gonna be late. It's all about survival now, right? Because everything's bad for us. We can't enjoy anything then anymore. Anybody here remember casual sex? Remember casual sex? 20, 30 years ago, you go out to a nice club like this, meet a perfect stranger. Go home, make love, wake up in the morning and feel good about yourself. Not anymore. Woo! Nowadays, you sleep with a stranger on Monday, you dead on Tuesday. You got to be careful. That's why it's very important, fellas, sleeping around casually, make sure you bring your own condom to the table. Why? Because women buy condoms there. Mm-hmm. And they will embarrass you with the ones that they pick out. See, they laughing. They know where the hell I'm going with this shit right here. Women tend to set their expectations a tad bit too high. Well, I'm gonna make love to watch one girl. She pulled out one of these Magnum condoms. You ever see the Magnum condom? Come in a gold case? Shit, I thought it was a new iPod. I didn't know what the hell that damn thing was. I opened that thing up, I swear to God, a hefty bag fell out that thing. Man, I put that thing on, I had my penis, my balls, everything was inside there. I damn near had my butt cheeks in it. I was like, this is ridiculous. Is this much air supposed to be in here? I said, we gonna make love or go to bed. I'm wrapped up in a sleeping bag over here. Some of y'all are laughing. The rest of the white women here looking at my crotch like, oh my God, what happened to hell? He didn't get one. I thought they all had one. Everything's bad for us, man. That's why you just gotta enjoy yourselves, man. Enjoy yourselves, man. We're trying to eat right. It's hard to eat right, right? Hard to eat right now because all the food is fucked up. Right, every time you eat something, the government tells you, bring it back. It's fucked up, bring it back. What they had last year, mad cow disease. The year after that, the bird flu. Remember the bird flu? Black people, remember the bird flu? All the chicken was fucked up. Boy, black people started losing weight all over the country, didn't we? No wings, no legs, no thighs, nothing for us to eat. Then the spinach went bad. White folks, you guys started losing weight all over the country. No quiche, no carbs, salad, nothing for y'all. Then the dog food was messed up. Dog lovers had their dogs on TV. Fluffy's dead. Somebody killed Fluffy. He ate the dog food. You ever notice ain't no black-owned dogs died, right? Uh-uh. No Latino dogs died. You know how we are, blacks and Latinos. We don't feed our dogs real dog food. I'm from the old school. When I was growing up, dog food was whatever's left over the dinner table. That was dog food. Boy, black people dogs be eating chitlins, ham hocks, rice and peas, peanut butter jelly sandwiches, M&Ms, Snickers bars, Ho-Hos, Ring-Dings, Tang, Kool-Aid, grape soda, orange soda, macaroni and cheese, collard greens, fried fish, fried chicken, Plantados, pizza, popcorn, honey bun, Ho-Hos, Ring-Dings, Tang, crackers, Twizzlers. That's why black people dogs be dying from the same stuff that be killing us. High blood pressure, diabetes, swollen ankles, club foot, pink eye, lupus, glaucoma, sickle cell, NYPD, LAPD, New Jersey State Trooper. Snitching. You go over blacks and Latinos, Al, you see a sick dog in a corner, be like, what's wrong with Midnight? Midnight got worms. His blood pressure's 800 over 800. They about to cut his foot off next week. Why? He ate a beef patty and cheese with a Heineken last night. Tore his ass up. Nothing was messed up in the country. Nobody's in love anymore. Nobody's in love. Some of you people in this room right now, coupled up, really don't give two shits about each other. You're only together now because you can't afford $1,200 a month rent by your goddamn self. And you're sitting in your chair, as soon as I get on my feet, I'm out of this bullshit right here, I'm out of this. Because everybody's cheating. The whole cheating scandal got out of hand when Tiger Woods got caught cheating, right? But like most men, Tiger Woods got caught cheating through his phone. Because man, let's face it, we don't know how to cheat. We cheat around, we leave all our cheating evidence in our phone. Pictures, text messages, everything. That's why the last thing any man could ever want happen in this room, you never want to go out with your girlfriend, your wife, or whatever, and her phone is dead. And then she asks you to borrow your phone to make a phone call. Ah! You will hand that phone over to her like you handed a loaded weapon to a five-year-old. Okay. Don't touch this part right here. Just don't touch this part. Just don't touch that part right there. Okay, fuck it. Give me the number. I'll dial it for you. Okay, this shit is talk. My name is Drew Fraser, everybody. Thank you so very, very, very much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Pete Dominic is taking the stage when we return.
So, we're here with Julie and Jim. They've been married for 17 years. Which, like, I've been married for less than five. I just feel like that's so long. So for 17 years, Julie, every morning you wake up, there's Jim. Every night you go to sleep, there's Jim. Jim in the morning, Jim at night. Jim in the morning, Jim at night. 365 days a year, year after year, for 17 fucking years.
That's why I married a fireman, because he's gone 10 days.
Oh, that's perfect. You're no dummy. That's my kind of girl. All right. I learned something from you, Julie. Here's your parting gift.
All right. We're ready to keep the show going.
Welcome back, everybody. Everybody has Sirius XM in their car. Am I right? Well, then you have to listen to our next guest every single day because he has his own show on Sirius XM. He's funny. He's handsome. He's my friend, Pete Dominic.
Susie Essman, come on. Where are you going? Stay here. I'm so excited to be here with you. I've always been very attracted to you. Mm-hmm. And I'm just thinking, you're very happily married, and I'm very happily married, but if we weren't, would you?
Well, my husband is bald with facial hair. Mm-hmm. So I could just, you know, open my eyes and pretend you're him.
What if you accidentally said my name, Pete?
That wouldn't happen.
I'll take it.
Okay.
Susie Essman, Curb Your Enthusiasm, huh? Thank you guys very much for braving coming out here on a it's freezing in New York and much of the country right now because it's February. And so that's expected, which is why I don't know about you, but I hate people who complain about the weather, especially when it's like small talk. That's what, and where does that always happen? Small talk about the weather, huh? Yeah, in the elevator. It's always, right, you know what I'm saying? Isn't that annoying? You're in a confined space. You know what? Just be confident enough to just ride for a few floors and you don't have to have a conversation. It happens so often, I've prepared rude lines to end the conversation. You know, because somebody always gets on, if it's really hot, really cold, you know, there's always that non-verbal, you know, they're about to start a conversation, right? Like a day like today, it's really freezing, some lady gets on the elevator, she's like, oh, here it comes. Ooh, freezing out there, huh? I want to be like, yeah, it is. I know that because like you, I'm a mammal. But I said this to a lady once, I go, yeah, it sure is. I hope no old people die. Just give that a shot. It's a real conversation ender. They'll just like hit the wrong floor to get away from you. So we've had enough time now, I think, for this audience and the audience at home, the millions of us watching at home, to get used to my head. Are you guys good? You need more time than that little weather small talk buffer joke? I think. Can we just agree? I'm not hurt by it. I think I'm a good-looking guy. I'm an average-looking guy. Can we just agree that bald and white under the age of 40 is always creepy? Can we, handsome? Huh? Can we, you Banana Republic-looking model, probably our gay guy? Can we? Look at you. Look at the skin on you. So, I mean, it's white and bald under a certain age. It's creepy. And bald black folks don't know our struggle. You just don't, you know. Black and dark colors hide blemishes. The white ball guy, you could see it all. It's just like, oh, look at that skull. It's just, yeah, it's just. It is, it's creepy. So I have two daughters. If anybody here has kids, know mine are better. So I take my kids to the park all the time. If they get like 10 feet away from me, it looks like I'm just at the playground. Okay, let it out. Don't clap. Just let the catharsis hit you, as you know I'm right. It's like picture me at 10 o'clock in the morning at a kid's playground, pair of sweatpants, t-shirt, cup of coffee, this head and my creepy gummy smile. I'm like, go ahead, girls. Daddy's right over here. I think did you just pee a little bit? Did you laugh so hard you pee a little? Make that weird noise like, I think I peed. Stop telling people that. Yeah, it's tough being bald, a white guy, you know? My daughter, kids are honest. My 8-year-old daughter, Ava, says to me the other day, she saw a picture of me with hair from a long time ago. Can you believe I used to have a very thick, luscious mane? And I literally look exactly like this guy right here. Exactly. Same physique, everything. You are attractive. Look at that camera, somebody home notes. Stand up and look at everybody. Go to look at you, John Stamos, if he was gay. Fucking gay Stamos. Gamos. So, I'm totally pro-equality, just so you know. No, my daughter saw an old picture of me with hair, and she says to me, she goes, Daddy, you were handsome. Because you were handsome. I go, well, you were an accident. As long as everybody's being honest here. So I'm happily married, but attracted to that guy. And I don't know what it is about you, fella. My wife's watching live right now. I'm going, oh my God, I have to get off Facebook. My wife is the greatest. It's such a mismatch, too. It really is. Like, my friends first met her when we first started dating. Your guy friends will always be honest. Like, dude, she's hot. And why are you saying it like that? No, I'm just saying. What are you just saying? No, nothing. I would have expected a minotaur, something hooven. What the hell? My wife looks like Courtney Cox. I look like Mr. Burns from The Simpsons. Don't laugh at that. Don't. No. Don't laugh and clap, asshole. I see you. Really? A hard clap, too. No, it's great. I love my wife. I hate when people bash their wives and guys bash. I love she is amazing. But we've been married. Well, you guys, this couple's married 17 years. That's you don't hear that a lot these days with porn that's so available. That's good. Can anybody top that in the audience tonight? Anybody more than 17 years? No, it's mostly young. They should be in bed. Let's be honest. You guys should be napping. But. No, we've been there 12 years, and it's great. We're still learning a lot about each other. Like, I found out a couple of years ago that my wife grinds her teeth at night, and I found this out because some of you know what I'm talking about. She wears a mouth guard to bed. I had no idea. We were together 10 years at that point. I had no idea she even owned this thing. One night, she just throws in this mouthpiece. We're getting in bed. She goes, you want to have sex? I'm like, no. Do you want to play hockey? What the hell's in your mouth? A goalie? What is that? Can I grind my teeth? I have to wear my mouth guard. How angry are you in the middle of the night that you're like? I make fun of her, though. I have my own sleep disorder. I have sleep apnea, which means you like stop breathing in the middle of the night and almost die. I was telling, you know, just every night I just have a dream that someone's choking me to death, and I'm just like, my wife's over there going. My buddy's a doctor. He goes, dude, you got to get this mask. Get to wear this mask to bed. I go, I'd rather die than wear a mask to bed at night. Can you imagine that? Imagine that sex, by the way. My wife's wearing a mouth guard, and I'm dressed up like Bane from Batman. My wife's like, you want to have sex? I'm like,
yes. Yes, I do want to have sex. Turn around. Turn around. Bruce Wayne.
Why did you call me Bruce Wayne? Just turn around. So I'm the romantic, thoughtful one in our relationship. I actually want to read you a text message I sent to my wife. This is a real text message I sent to my wife to show you that I'm the romantic and thoughtful one, and she is not. And she is watching. You should know. This is what I sent to my wife. I'm just going to read the exact interchange, and then I'm going to leave the stage. Many of you will fall in love with me just at how romantic this text message is. I should warn you. This is what I wrote to my wife. Verbatim. I was watching Matt Damon on Piers Morgan's show last night, and Piers asked him, if you could go back and relive any moment of your life, what would it be? And I thought, my moment that I'd want to relive is the moment I met you. That's right, ladies. Sir, nothing. I wrote, I remember it like it was yesterday, and I think that's where I want my ashes to be spread. This is what my wife wrote back to me. Matt Damon was on Piers Morgan last night. My name is Pete Dominic. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good night.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Rachel Feinstein is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Well, I have to tell you, nothing makes me happier than a funny woman. So you are in for a treat. You've seen her on Comedy Central, on Chelsea lately. Please welcome Rachel Feinstein.
Thank you so much. It's good to be here. I just got back from Alabama. I had this weird show there. I was in the middle of my set, and I asked if they had any Jews there. I guess it was kind of a dumb question. I don't know. It got, like, real quiet and just sort of clansy, and then this one man just stands up in the middle of my show, and he just goes, there's the Jew. She's over there. And he just points to, like, a rogue Jew in the back of the room. I'm like, you're tracking your Jews. That is not a soothing feeling. The Jew looked like he was used to it. He just got up and scampered like Jews do. And we all scamper. I I went home and I was telling my parents about it. I was like, Dad, they tracked their Jews in Birmingham, right? My dad was like, oh, that's nothing. I got something better than that. My dad likes to try to like top things that don't need to be topped in any way. And he goes, when I was a kid, there was a family that would, you know, come out in the front lawn and hiss at me every morning because I was a Jew. And I'm like, really? That was like their family activity? That's kind of hilarious, just Jew hissing with their father. And he goes, oh, yeah, he did it for years. I'm like, they probably have a lot of, like, beautiful memories of, like, Jew hiss. Maybe there was, like, nothing else to do in that town, and the father, like, rounded him up like it was a field trip. Like, Tammy, Don, Cletus, we going Jew hissing. Wear something practical. Don't be outside for a while. It was weird being at, like, with my parents. I don't know if anybody feels like this. I'm good for like 24 hours at my parents' house, and then I'm like, get the fuck away from me. I can't. I have to leave. I cannot deal with them. My mom likes to have these kind of like sassy moments with strangers. She just likes to kind of touch base with everybody. She basically just frightens people with her hostile jazzercise energy. She talks to everybody and just kind of gets in their face. Like, we were out to dinner. The waiter comes over. He says something completely reasonable. He was just like, hey, we're really slammed right now. I'll be right back. Here's my mother's unacceptable response to this man. She goes, oh, please, take your time. I lived in California in the 1960s. I'm like, what the fuck does that mean? This is not acceptable. No one knows what you're referring to. And it frightens people. So please stop. And her newest thing she does is she likes to show everybody that she's just very culturally aware and just kind of down with everything culturally. Just kind of likes to let everybody know how liberal she is. But whenever she does this, she just ends up sounding like vaguely racist. The latest thing she's doing that's horrifying us is my mom thinks when you go out to a Latin restaurant that it's respectful to order in a Spanish accent. I'm like, Mom, you're a wild asshole. You have to stop. You're going to get shot. She won't listen to anyone. She doesn't give a shit. We were out, and she's like, I'll have the taco el carbon. I'm like, what was that? Some sort of a bird call that you just did? She'll just keep going. She has no perception of, like, how she's being received. She doesn't give a shit. She'll just be like, you know, we're at this Mexican restaurant. My mom just kind of saddles into this poor waiter, and she goes, we love Latino culture. We recently had a wonderful trip to Nicaragua. And I'm like, why would the Mexican waiter care about your Nicaraguan trip? You're such a dick. The guy's just like glaring at her like, you awful white bitch. And she's like, we loved the people there. We thought they had these large, brown, curious eyes. We thought they were so inspiring. They just kind of sit by the side of the road and they just sort of weave these incredible pieces. These beautiful young child slaves. And all you do is just give them a quarter and they'll just make anything for you. That is just one quarter and they whip it up. Oh, the Spanish are so speedy. They always have them. You can't give them any more than that though, because then they'll follow you and they'll ruin your vacation. And they start asking for food and water and Lord knows what. Boy, are they devious. I don't give them any more than just one quarter. And they'll try to sew real slow so they get more dough out of you. But I have fun with them. I'll just give her a little kick and I'll say, come on, bitch, you're seven. You can go faster than that. Come on, Carmen. I got a plane to catch. Don't you fuck up my turquoise cape. I need it for book club. My mom does not like that joke. She's always like, can you take that one out of your talent show? That's what she calls my stand-up, my talent show. She goes, I do not support child slavery. Take it out of your talent show. My parents are both kind of crazy. Nobody really taught me anything about how to be like a proper woman. Obviously, my mom's not well. My grandma was also vaguely frightening. I spent a lot of time with my grandma when I was a kid. Like, she would give me a lot of advice, never appropriate. I was just like playing with blocks on my floor as a kid, and my grandma would be like, only whores wear purple. I'm like, what? Can I apply that? She had a lot of specific rules about whores. She's like, only whores carry birds. I'm like, that's not fair. What about the bird lovers out there? No, they're all godless sluts. They're all terrible. What else? I just broke up with my boyfriend. Isn't that sad? Thank you. I know. I still have stuff at his place. It's like awkward. You know, like I don't want to see him, but I feel like I need to be an adult about it and just call him up and be like, look, I left a hair in your sink that I need. So if we can meet at some sort of a neutral location, like Cancun. I'll bring the poems I wrote about you and you can fall asleep inside me. Does that sound... Thank you. God bless you, and God bless America. He would give me a hard time a lot, like, because he would always say I was inappropriate. I like to joke right after sex. For me, I think that's a good time for some jokes. And he would always get mad at me. Like, I like to pretend like the guy tricked me into it. That's very funny to me. I like to pretend like it's like the olden days and I'm just a real moron and the moment sex is done, I like to be like, well, I don't understand what this had to do with the children getting their cure for polio. Oh, you promised. You said if we did all those terrible things, those children wouldn't have to die. It was all a lie, wasn't it? And now look at me just laying here all covered in sin. I feel like the right guy is gonna be like, hey, sugar tits, all those children, they never had a fucking chance, all right? They're in a pile right now, just mangled with polio. Now clean yourself up, for Christ's sake. Thank you so much, that's it for me.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Fred Ernst is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
All right, welcome back. Our next guest, you've seen him on Comedy Central, and if you like him, which you're going to, he will be headlining here, right here, at Gotham Comedy Club in New York City on West 23rd Street between 7th and 8th. Please welcome Brett Ernst.
Keep it going for Susie, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, I'll be here all weekend, so come check me out. No, I live in LA, and I just got off the plane. I used to live here, and yeah, as soon as I get off the plane, I'm like, fuck this, it's freezing. No, but then I go to get a sandwich, and then I got behind the guy that overdoes the Italian. Like, you ever see the guy ordering the sandwich but has to pronounce the deli meats like he actually speaks Italian? You ever see this jerk off? My cousin's like this. Like, every time we go out, I was like, I gotta get a sandwich. Excuse me, you guys, you got any gabagol? You got gabagol? You got any prosciutto? Any mortadella? Any mozzarella? It's like, dude, you don't speak Italian, man. You just... You're just pronouncing deli meats really loud. It's fucking embarrassing. And we're at Subway. What the fuck are you doing? They don't have broccoli or rabe at Subway, asshole. No, he does. He overdoes the mob thing. Like, there's always that guy, like the old Italian guy, always wants you to think he's like in the mob. Like, every time we go out to eat, my buddy's this guy. He's like, yo, I gotta sit facing the door. I gotta see who's coming in. Nobody's trying to whack you. You put up sheetrock. What the fuck are you worried about, man? Nah, but, you know, I like stereotypes, by the way. I think we earn them. I hate how people get upset. If, like, look, if your group stereotype, it's not like there's meetings where people get together and just make shit up about your group. It's your group behaving a certain way over a long period of time that everybody's fucking noticing. Like, I used to stereotype all the time, man. I do it all the time. Well, I used to wait tables, that's why. I don't know if anybody's ever waited tables, but there's certain, yeah, you know. First of all, that job sucks ass, man. Like, Like, you know your job sucks when you get mad when people just come in. You know what I mean? I'd be at work, people would show up. I'm like, fuck, man, why do you gotta eat here? You know, like, it's their fault. And there are certain groups of people you don't want to wait on. Like, you could call it racial profiling. I call it you never waited tables before in your fucking life, man. And I'll tell you the worst group ever, hands down. And I'm not pandering to the crowd, but rich white women. I hate you. I hate your face. Because they always walk in with that face on like they just smelled shit and they're lost. And I was like... And they just walk in complaining. Everything's always unacceptable. Sir, I've been waiting 3 minutes. I married someone who accomplished something. I demand service. Now why is this table dirty? It's disgusting. Why is it dirty? Because people are still eating. And they sing when they order. It's so annoying. Like, they have this little inflection in their voice. So it's like, I'm ready to order. It's like, all right, what can I get for you? I think I'm going to take a salad, but I don't want any croutons or lettuce. Bitch, it's a salad. Like, I'll kick you to sleep. Yeah, all right, let's see. Rich white women suck. Any Middle Eastern group, anybody with the ech and the ech in the language, have fun. Enjoy yourself. Enjoy getting yelled at all fucking night long. All they do is yell. I don't know if they even know how to talk. Because their language is so aggressive. Like, they just fucking yell at you. You'd be like, hey, how you folks doing? Where is my bread? Like, I didn't know you wanted bread. Where is the drink? Okay, I'll get you something to drink. I'm ready to go. My friend. But buddy, buddy. I am, Middle Eastern suck. Black people suck. I don't know if you ever wait on brothers, man. They always want you to hook them up with shit. Brothers act like they've known you for years, man. You come up to the table, they're all happy. They're like, hey, man, hey. Hey, it's me. Hey, it's me. Hey, my dude. Hey, man, hey, you gonna hook me? Come on, are you gonna hook me? I don't fucking know you. Oh, and brothers love strawberry lemonade. I don't know if you know that. Brothers love that shit. They see it on the menu, they lose their fucking mind, man. Their voice goes up like 12 octaves because they get all excited and shit. They'll see it, they're like, oh, hell no, man. You got strawberry lemonade, I'm gonna smell the fuck. Like, hey, hook me up! It's like, I don't know you. Brothers love fruity drinks, man, I'm telling you. You ever see like a family out to dinner, black, look on the table, like red drinks, blue drinks, pink drinks, like, they look like they're dying fucking Easter eggs. I can't really talk about the place I worked for. I'm not supposed to. I worked for a corporate, we'll just call it the shit cake factory. I'll blow that fucking place up, man. Because they had like 8,000 items on the menu. It's like, really? You need that much shit? And they train you. You know what I mean? Like, I'm in a classroom, like a dick, studying menu items. That's how you know your life sucks, by the way, when you're cheating on food tests. You're like, hey, man, what kind of onions are in the jambalaya? And then it just sinks in. God, I'm a loser. Yeah, I'm a reform loser. I used to be a jerk off back in the day. Like, I don't know if anybody over 30, like, remember that one asshole in the club back in the day with just a vest on? Remember that dick? Who goes out with just a vest? What are you, Han Solo? But I got to tell this story real quick before I close. My mom's watching, so this is her favorite story. It's how she caught me jerking off. Now, I don't know, I'm serious. I don't know if anybody's ever been caught rubbing one out, but like when your girl catches you, it becomes a problem. Now you gotta talk about it, you have to have a sit down. But like when your mom catches you, you don't have to say a word. They're awesome, they don't say a fucking word. Like they walk in, or like, I remember I was rubbing one out, she's like, hey Brett, okay, turn around and left, right? Now I gotta do this real quick. So anyway, so I'm out one night drinking with my friends, right? I'm hammered, okay? That's usually how these stories start off, right? So I come home hammered, and I decide I gotta, you know, get one off. So I'm laying in bed, and this is back in the VCR days. I used to hide my porn in plain sight. I don't know if any guy ever did that with the VHS tapes. Like my porn tape said, like, NFL's greatest hits, you know? So I'm laying there, I put the VHS tape in, right? The room's spinning, I get butt naked. Okay. Now, ladies, every guy has their own technique. Fellas, this is mine. Put this in your pocket, take it home with you. Just be a little bit more careful.
So what I do is whenever I'm rubbing out in bed, I don't know if you guys do this, all right? You ever make like that little toilet paper runway? Right here, it's like nice, quick, easy cleanup. You just throw it under the bed, you wake up the next morning, get rid of the evidence, right? So I'm laying there butt naked, drunk, got my little root in my hand, covered in toilet paper, like covered in Charmin 2-ply, because I knew it was gonna be a strong one, right? So I'm sitting there, and I'm so drunk, I'm starting to rub one out, I just pass out, right? When I wake up the next morning, the TV's off, okay? And I'm tucked in my bed. And my poor mom, just imagine being a mom, walking in, seeing your son laying there, butt naked, covered in toilet paper, with just a vest on. And she's never said a word, which is why I love my mama. Hey, God bless you guys. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV. Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City.
Did we have a good time tonight? Did everybody enjoy themselves? Did you all grow and change as human beings? Did anybody have an epiphany? Did anything happen here tonight besides tons of laughter? Anything? I hope the hell not. I hope so. Let's bring up our comedians that we love tonight. Drew Frazier, Pete Dominic.